As you know, I always begin with the Old Testament, and then I will go over to the New Testament. Thank God for that level that He has taken me to. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Just one scripture that I'll be reading from Joel chapter 2. And then, praise God, there will be other scriptures that will be following. Amen. Hallelujah. Joel chapter 2, reading from verse 12. Therefore also, now saith the Lord. Now saith the Lord. Amen. Now saith the Lord means that the Lord is speaking. Amen. The Lord is speaking now. Amen. Turn you even to me with all of your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. Fasting, weeping, and mourning. And rend your heart, and not your garments. And turn unto the Lord your God, for He is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Praise God. I'm going to focus very briefly on verse 13. Praise God. And then I always follow the leading of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is going to lead me to some other verses in the New Testament. Praise God. In verse 13, it says, and rend your heart and not your garments. Now, the term rend is defined to tear apart something. But when the prophet Joel prophesied to the Old Testament church, Israel, to rend their heart, it was a personal call for a genuine repentance that comes from a broken spirit and a contrite heart. To rend your heart is also a plea for God's mercy when sin is committed. Church, I want to assure you, we can't go into God's holy presence, who is the creator of our innermost being, with an outward appearance. Because true repentance is not a matter of words only. True repentance is not just saying, God, I am sorry for my sins. True repentance is a matter of the heart. Listen, if your heart is truly broken by your sin, and you have the desire to return and reconcile back to God, then it must begin in your heart.
Amen.
And it also involves a commitment to move forward in daily sanctification, righteousness, and holiness. Listen, church, the only way to avert the impending judgment of God is to repent. And God, who is merciful, gracious, long-suffering, and full of compassion, would forgive you. Only under one condition is when you get it right with Him. Amen. Now, many of us, and I have said previously, we have made poor choices in the past that causes us to regret. But you don't have to live with the consequences of the past. Because when you repent, God will restore you back into fellowship with him. Amen. God is merciful when you rend your heart in full repentance for your sins. Listen, praise God, the more you read God's word, you will discover that all of our human emotions is experienced by the heart. Amen. For example, in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 34, Matthew chapter 12 and verse 34, Jesus said, O generation of vipers, how can you being evil speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speak. Amen. Now the word abundance here means to overflow. Therefore, when love, peace, joy, bitterness, unforgiveness, and hate is overflowing in your heart, your mouth will be open and declare them to come to pass. Your mouth will speak what is coming out of it. No doubt, these words will change your character and will determine your eternal destiny. Amen. In Romans chapter 10 and verse 8 says, but what say it? The word is near thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. Now, if God's word is going to work for us, then it has to be in our heart and in our mouth. If God's word is only in your mouth and not in your heart, the word cannot work for us. For example, when you dial the thermostat on the wall to 70 degrees, the unit will work until it brings the house to that temperature. The unit was designed to produce what you dial into it. Amen? So your heart will produce what you dial into it. For example, if you dial on forgiveness, iniquity, rebellion, envy, jealousy, and malice in your heart will produce these hellbound system. Yes. Amen. On the other hand, if you dial into your heart love, peace, joy, compassion, and forgiveness, your heart will produce these heavenly bond system. The output is the result of the input.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Now, the conclusion of this verse says that is the word of faith which we preach. But the question is, church, how does the word of faith work? The word of faith works by preaching the word in our heart, by speaking the word that is in our heart. But the word of faith cannot work if you are believing God for one thing with your heart and saying something else with your mouth.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Your heart and your mouth must be in agreement if your faith is going to work. Now, many Christians, they want to walk with God and yet they disagree with his word. But how can you walk with God and at the same time you disagree with his word? The Bible says Enoch walked with God. Why Enoch walked with God is because Enoch and God was in agreement. Amen. Praise God. You have to agree with what God say in his word. Amen. Now in Psalms 51 and verse 10, David rend his heart in true repentance. David prayed, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. A clean heart and a right spirit. Now there is no denying of the fact of the terrible sin David had committed. As a matter of fact, David's sin cannot be without excuse. Because when Nathan the prophet, you must have a man of God in your life. Amen. When Nathan the prophet confronted David for his sin, David was filled with remorse. And he repented for his sins, and God in his mercy forgave David. David knew that a clean heart, it requires genuine repentance. And only God alone can cleanse him from his sin. Now, church, although we are born with an unclean heart, we are reborn with a clean heart. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 23 says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed. Twice we have been born. Physical birth, and now, amen, praise God, a spiritual birth. Amen, praise God. Now, praise God, the word of God that we receive, it abideth and liveth forever. Now, before we were born again, we were the corruptible seed. That is before we accept Jesus Christ into our lives and he changed our lives. Now that we have been born again, we are no longer the corruptible seed, but the incorruptible seed. Now, this radical cleansing requires by David can only come from God. Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. We need to go before God with a clean heart and a right spirit. Now notice, David continued his prayer of repentance. David said, and renew a right spirit within me. Within me, praise God. You see, everything is within, praise God, amen. But how many of you know, church, it is not possible for you to have a right spirit and a clean heart if there is unconfessed sin in your life? Unrighteous living and rebellion in your life. As a matter of fact, to have a right spirit, you must not persist, amen, or sin must not persist in your life. Sin must be put away and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 22 says, that you put off, watch this, that you put off the former conversation, the old man which is corrupt. Now, to put off literally means to take off. Yeah. Now, this verse is parallel to Colossians chapter 3 and verse 8, which says that you put off all these things. Watch this, wrath, malice, blasphemy, amen, praise God, and filthy communication out of your mouth. Now, these are the dirty clothing you need to put off or to take off. Now, this dirty clothing, praise God, is a representation of the old man that is corrupt. The old Adamic nature that we were born with, the sin nature. Amen. The not good things in our flesh. Now the old man who is who we were before we get saved. Who we were before we were born again. Who we were before we become new creature in Christ Jesus. Amen. Who we were, praise God, amen, before the old man, praise God, was crucified with Christ. Now, church, praise God, our lifestyle was worldly. But now, praise God, there is no need for us to live a worldly lifestyle. Amen. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away, and behold, all things become new. Amen. Praise God. When the old man with a worldly lifestyle, praise God, driven by the sinful nature or sinful desire, we were dressed up with anger, malice, bitterness, blasphemy, and filthy communication. Therefore, we must renounce our pre-conversation life of sin and take off this dirty clothing in the name of Jesus Christ. The New Testament, it shaped our character. It disciplines us. Amen. It teaches us how to live holy. Amen. In the presence of God. Now, if we try in our own effort to reform the old man, the old Adamic nature, the old sinful nature, the no good things in the flesh that is corrupt, amen, you wouldn't be successful. Amen. Praise God. You would never change because you are doing it on your own, whereas that is the work of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes, amen, praise God, we want to do only what the Holy Spirit is capable of doing. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1, it says, therefore, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and the spirit. What's this? Perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. Amen. Now, after Jesus Christ saved us by his loving grace, we are expected to cleanse ourselves by turning away from everything that will contaminate our flesh and the spirit. After Jesus Christ saved us, we must break away from every form of ungodliness, amen, and compromise that will contaminate our flesh and our spirit. Now, perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord is a continual process. Listen, we can only perfect holiness in the fear of the Lord by walking in the Spirit. Amen. As believers, we must plead to God for personal holiness. What's this? To mature externally in the flesh and mature internally in the spirit. That's why we're told in Romans chapter 12, the Apostle Paul speaking to the believers in the Romans church, he said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It has to do with the total man, the whole man, spirit, inside, soul, inside, body, external. That's why the Apostle Paul says, I keep under this body and I bring it into subjection. What Paul meant is this, praise God, amen. Before he got saved, the body was in control. The body caused the shots, amen. But after he gets saved, praise God, the spirit that is born again is now controlling the body. Body, I will not allow you to do whatever you want to do.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
God. Church. Holiness is a lifestyle. Amen. It is a life of daily sanctification and purification. Watch this, church. There is no eternal life without holiness. Amen. Let me say that again. There is no eternal life without holiness. Nobody is going to access the kingdom of God in an unholy state. You got to be holy. Churches don't like to speak about holiness today. But you have to thank God, amen, that you are in a small little flock, amen, that preach holiness, because it's not the majority of people that is going to make it into the kingdom of God. It is the minority. That's why he said many are called, but few are chosen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Yeah. Amen. So, there is no eternal life without holiness. For those of us who have been justified can surely give evidence of this fact by the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 16, we are told to walk in the Spirit. Now, to walk in the Spirit is in the present tense. Not in the future tense, it's now. Amen. Praise God. It is a daily spiritual walk that is prompted by the power of the Holy Spirit. Walking in the Spirit enables us to live a godly life that pleases God. Now, this is the result when we walk in the Spirit. Amen. The same verse says, and we shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, the lust of the flesh is the strong desire of the sinful nature that we were born with. Amen. Or we inherit from birth. Now, to conquer the lust of the flesh is to have dominion over it by walking in the Spirit. The flesh has to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. The flesh has to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. If the flesh is not controlled by the Holy Spirit, I can assure you, you will fulfill the lust of the flesh. It's a battle. There will always be a battle between the flesh and the Spirit that is born again. You see, when a person is born again, it's not the flesh that is born again. It is the Spirit that is born again. But the Spirit will conquer the flesh by bringing it into subjection.
Amen.
Romans 6:12 says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey the lust thereof. Notice verse 17 says, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And watch this. This is the warfare. This is the battle. And these are contrary one to another. Now here we see the flesh and the Spirit cannot agree. The flesh and the Spirit cannot harmonize. There will never be any agreement between the flesh and the Spirit. Why? Because the flesh and the Spirit, they both have desire that are contrary to one another. That's what the word said. They're contrary.
Hallelujah.
That means they keep opposing each other. The flesh is the evil, sinful desire of the human nature that oppose the Spirit. On the other hand, the Spirit oppose and subdue the evil desire of the flesh. Now here we see the born-again Christian believers is the battlefield that is caught up in a tug of war spiritually. Listen, without the help of the Holy Spirit, we cannot overcome the lust of the flesh. Now verse 17 may leave the impression that we are caught up in a hopeless tug of war between the flesh and the Spirit, but we are not. Verse 18 says, but if you are led by the Spirit, now you would have to decide who will lead you in your relationship with God. You would have to decide on that. In other words, you either be led by the Holy Spirit or you be led by the flesh. Amen. But you can't be led by the flesh and the Holy Spirit at the same time. It's not going to work. Amen? Now, in Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9, it says, what's this? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Who can know it? Now, first of all, the heart is the inner being of a person, amen, which include his desires and feelings. Now, as a result of a desperately wicked heart that is evil and corrupt, the heart is incurable, sick, and cannot be changed. Watch this. The only remedy is to experience God's grace and be born again through the saving faith of Jesus Christ. That is the only way the heart, praise God, can be cured. Amen. Now listen, when God changed a desperately wicked heart that is hopeless and corrupt, only then that person will be delighted in doing the will of God. And doing God's will is obedient to his word, which enables us to live a life of righteousness, purity, and holiness. Listen, only God knows the condition and corruption of a desperately wicked heart. Only God knows what is in our heart before we know it. Only God knows what is in our heart before we know it. Because what is in our heart cannot be masked. The false mask that we, I didn't say you, but we, including me, the false mask, amen, that we wear to disguise our real feeling and real intention may fool others around us, but we can't fool God. Hallelujah, amen. Why? Because God sees all of our jealousy. God sees all of our ugliness. God sees all of our rage. God sees all of our anger and deceitfulness. I was once in this realm. That's the way I preach. I don't scold you. When I preach, I use the plural we. Yeah. In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 24, if you have been scolded, it's the word of God that is scolding you. Amen? Amen. Jesus said, if any man shall come after me, if any man shall come after me. Now, the term any man is not limited to Jesus' disciples only. But following Jesus is extended to all men who would follow Jesus and to have a relationship with him. Now, notice, Jesus said, let him deny himself. Now, this does not mean to deny things to yourself. Doesn't mean that. But to follow Jesus on the road to glory, which is a narrow way that leads to eternal life, is not going to be easy. Amen? To follow Jesus, it requires complete devotion, dedication, willing obedience, loyalty, and commitment. You must surrender your self-will to God. You must deny your own sinful nature and become the new creature in Jesus Christ. But if you see your own self, your own will, and your own desire more important to you rather than doing God's will, you're still not denying yourself. If you want people to take note of what you're doing so that you can puff up with pride, you are still not denying yourself. If you try to make God's glory your own by turning the spotlight only on yourself, you are still not denying yourself. To deny yourself is to reject your wrong thinking, your wrong believing, and your wrong motives, which is which springs from the old sinful nature.
Hallelujah.
But when you choose God's divine will for your life, you will gradually become the new person that Christ died for you to become.
Amen.
Now notice Jesus said, take up your cross and follow him. Now the cross is not only a symbol of death and suffering, but it points to the individual separating himself from the old life of sin and have made a decision to follow Jesus and to do God's will, whatever it costs. Listen, to follow Jesus requires full commitment and total obedience that would take precedence over other duties in your personal life. Because your commitment to Jesus is not limited. Amen. Listen to this. Your commitment to Jesus is not limited. The word of God is not limited in your life. Amen. God's word is unlimited. Because the more you study God's word, the more he reveals the unsearchable riches of Christ in your life.
Yeah.
Now, when you decide to follow Jesus, watch this. He would demand absolute authority over your life. Jesus demands personal sacrifice. Jesus wants us to concentrate completely on serving him. Commitment to Jesus is paramount in the life of every born-again believer. In Luke chapter 9 and verse 62, Jesus said unto him, no man hath put in his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Now, the term fit here means suitable or able. But if you make life lesson matters of greater priority than God's work, you will be of no use to him. Why? Because you are not ready to receive life in the way that Jesus taught you. You're still holding on to your past, sinful past. Instead of leaving your past behind as done and settled, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 25, and whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. God. Now, if you refuse to place your entire life in Jesus, or you try to live outside of Christ, you will lose it. If you reject the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the power of God unto salvation, you will lose your life eternally in the lake of fire. And according to Revelation chapter 20 and verse 14, which says, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. Death and hell were cast into, there will be no more hell, there will only be the lake of fire. Jesus continued, and whosoever shall lose his life for my sake shall save it. Now, to lose your life for Christ's sake is to give up your whole life to him. When you place your entire life in Christ, you will find your fullness of life in him. As a matter of fact, you will find life more abundantly. That's why he said, for the thief cometh not but for the kill, steal and to destroy, but I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Why? Because that's why it's important to keep looking exclusively to Jesus Christ to maintain this eternal life. Now, by this choice, you lose your old self and you become your new self to follow Jesus. Jesus continued in verse 26. He said, "What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what shall a man gain in exchange for his soul?" Now, this is what I call profit and loss. Listen, your soul is worth more than all the wealth and riches that this world has to offer. You cannot have a relationship with God and at the same time you're compromising with the world. Stop it. Amen? Because you don't know the day that your life is going to be expired. Amen? From this earth. Death doesn't warn you. It comes unexpectedly. That's why you always have to be ready. You always have to be prepared. Amen? Praise God. One or the other must go. One or the other must go. Amen? Praise God. Now listen. We gain when we follow Jesus. But we lose when we choose not to follow him. It benefits us when we lose the old nature or the old life in exchange for the new. Finally, in John chapter 9 and verse 1, it says, "And Jesus passed by," God, "and he saw a man born blind." He saw a man born blind from his birth. Notice, from his birth. Now, this point to the fact that he was born in that condition. He was born in that situation. He was born in that circumstances. This man was unable to see physically. His blindness hindered his mobility. He was permanently blind and hopeless until Jesus Christ shows up. When Jesus shows up in your situation, he will turn your hopeless situation around. That's why you have to trust him. That's when you're going through some things in life, pain, etc., pray or other things, amen. Just pray that Jesus show up. Show up. Yes. Show up, Jesus. Show up.
Amen.
Because when he shows up, it makes a lot of difference.
Hallelujah.
And verse 2, what is now? Verse 2 says, "And his disciple asked him, 'Master, who did sin? This man or his parent?'" Now, this question has to do with this man's blindness.
Yeah.
The disciples believed that a person born blind was either his parent's sin or the child could sin in the womb. So when the disciples asked Jesus the question, "Who did sin? This man or his parents?" Their focus was on sin and blindness rather than on this man's need. Their focus was more on this man's problem and his situation. Listen, the more we focus on people's circumstances and situation, you would have no compassion on them. Amen. Praise God. And you know what? You would anticipate the worst possible outcome in their lives. But notice, amen, how Jesus responded to the disciples' question in verse 3. Jesus said, he dropped the bombshell here. He said, neither this man sin or his parents sin. Now, what Jesus just did, he corrected the disciples' erroneous belief that not every serious affliction or calamity is a result of sin. Some sickness does result from sin, but not in this case. Notice Jesus said, neither this man or his spirit sin. Hallelujah, praise God. It's always good to sit at the feet of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Now what is church? At times, what is? God will allow affliction to fulfill his divine purpose. So God himself will get the glory out of it, as was in the case of Job. Notice, Jesus said, neither this man sin or his parents sin. That's how they were operating in the presence of the omnipresent God from a state of carnality. They were operating in the natural. You see, Jesus refused to judge this man's question on who did sin, him or his parents. You see, Jesus shows compassion, love, and mercy. And Jesus was more concerned with this blind man's need rather than to wrestle with a religious issue. Jesus continued. What is he said? But the works always look for the best in people. Don't anticipate the worst in their lives. Because you don't know, pray that what God has invested in the life of that individual. Amen, praise God. You don't know. Always anticipate the best and not the worst. Jesus continued, he said, but the work of God should be manifested, amen, in him. Not if the work of God will be manifested in this blind man. The works of God will be manifested in your sickness. Hallelujah. No, the works of God that will be manifested in the life of this blind man, you know what? Healing. That is the work of God, not the work of man. Deliverance. That is the work of God, not the works of man. Faith, that is the work of God, not the works of man. And restoration, praise God, will be manifested in the life of this blind man. Listen, but I know what captured my attention. When the word of God is manifested, when the works of God is manifested in your life, you will worship and glorify God. You will become more aware of his presence in your life. Amen. Praise God. And his influence. Amen. And you will confess what God has done for you. It's always good to confess what God has done for you. Not just getting up and testify just like that. Amen. Praise God. You want to know what God takes for you during the week. Praise God. Amen. It's time for you to start confessing some miracles.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. It's time for you to start confessing God has brought me from point A to point B. Yes, it's time to start confessing, praise God, and testify, praise God, that God has taken me to my next level. Aren't you tired of hearing? Well, he woke me up this morning. You want to hear more than that? You want to hear something more? And God, you woke me up this morning. Put food on my table. Pray. I want to see some miracles. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. I want to see something happening in our lives, church. Praise God. It is very important. Amen. Where God brought you from. Praise God. Amen. It's extremely important. Always keep advancing. Always keep making progress spiritually. That's what faith does. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Faith is a progressive development. You must keep moving forward all the time. Amen. You will confess what God has done for you. Now what is? The works of God given to Jesus is to work it. The gift that God gave to you is in order for you to work it. Work it. Amen. Praise God. Don't allow the gift to lie within you stagnant. Amen. Praise God. Amen. God cannot get any glory out of it. And in verse 5, Jesus said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. You see, Jesus is the true light from God that removes darkness and deception. Listen, when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, no doubt, He will deliver you from this present evil world. He will deliver you from sin, satanic influence, and you will be illuminated to God and salvation. But for those who walk in darkness and does not follow Jesus, who is the true light, will never know Him as the true light. Amen. And in closing, verse 6 says, and Jesus spit on the ground. Brother D, you see, Jesus spit on the ground. And then, what is now? He made clay of the spit. And then, take the clay. And then, he anointed. He didn't just put, but he anointed the eyes of the blind man with clay. The clay was mixed with spit. If you're desperate, you need healing, you don't care if somebody spit in your eyes. I need to see. Now, Jesus usually healed by speaking the word of God. But this healing was different. He mixed clay with spit and anointed the blind man's eyes. And according to verse 7, hallelujah, the man received his sight.
Amen. Amen.
God, amen. You see, God chose the foolish things of this world to confound the wise.
Yes.
That's why never ever, we should never ever place ourselves in that position that we have landed and that we have know it all. Amen. Let us continue to humble ourselves by the grace of God, and He will exalt us. Amen. In due time. So I'm going to close here. To God be the glory. And great things He has done. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
My way grows to you, precious Lord. Linger near when my life is on. Take my hand, fresh. precious Lord, and lead me home. Precious Lord.